Okay, so after the slip, another important mechanism is twinning. So what do we mean by twinning? It is not really the kind of dislocation motion that we have discussed so far, as in the case of slip. It is primarily due to atomic displacement, which are not necessarily the integer multiples of the Burgess vector. We will see in a moment how this twinning deformation takes place. And this is typically the mechanism that is observed in HCP materials and BCC materials, but not so much in FCC. FCC materials primarily deform due to slip, whereas HCP and BCC you can observe some twinning happening, but sometimes it is not that FCC materials will never show twinning. They may also show twinning, but it is not so prominent as in the case of HCP and BCC materials. Okay. So let us say this is your crystal lattice and you have this polished surface, and then let us look at this plane and let us say this is your twin plane. Like in the case of slip plane, we have discussed what is a slip plane, right? So similarly, let us consider this as a slim twin plane, and now you have applied a shear stress. Okay. Then what happens is the atoms on one side of the slip twin plane move with respect to the another atoms on the other side of the slip plane in such a way that they become mirror images about the slip twin plane. So for instance, that means this atom should move in such a way that this becomes mirror image of this guy, okay, and so on. So let us see how that happens. So the dark circles now shows the deformed configuration of the same system. So I have actually increased the number of things, but doesn't matter, right? And now you see that this guy is here, and that is the mirror image of that guy about the slip plane. And this guy, similarly, this guy has moved here, and this became mirror image of that guy, and so on. So as a result, now if you see what is the amount of atomic displacement, it is actually less than the interatomic spacing within that in the direction, right? Whereas in the case of slip, always your slip amount of slip is integer multiples of your Burgess vector. Burgess vector is the direction of the slip, isn't it? So always amount of slip caused by dislocation motion is always expressed as integer multiples of Burgess vector. Whereas in this case, for twinning, you should not have that much of a deformation. The deformation is constrained by the requirement that about the twin plane, you should have a mirror image of atoms from on one side with the atoms on the other side. If you have a deformation mechanism, if you have a plastic deformation of that kind, and such a deformation is called twinning deformation. Okay, and like in the case of slip, so you can also have a plastic deformation by glide of a plane of atoms compared to motion of dislocations, right? Individual atoms break the bond and re-establish the bond, right? There is a difference between the amount of energy that one needs to spend in order to create slip by glide of a plane of atoms compared to slip by dislocation motion. Compared to the amount of energy required to cause slip by dislocation motion is much smaller than the amount of energy required to cause slip by glide of a plane of atoms. Right, that means the dislocations are helping you to do slip. Similarly, here what we have shown is a perfect lattice, how the twinning deformation takes place. Same as in the case of slip, the dislocations here also can help twinning. So the amount of theoretical strength required for causing twinning deformation is usually much larger compared to when the dislocations come and help this twinning deformation, right? Then the dislocation motion, that the Burgess vector will not be integer multiples of, so that the slip will not be equal to integer multiples of Burgess vector, but some non-integer multiples of Burgess vector, right? As we can see here. All right. So a shear force can produce atom displacement such that one side of a plane of atoms that is called twin boundary are located in mirror image positions of the atoms on the other side. Does not mean that only atoms on one side of the plane should move. effectively both of them may be moving, but effectively they should move in such a way that after the deformation you should be able to find the mirror image positions on across the twin plane. That is what we mean by twin deformation, and typically it is much more difficult energetically compared to slip. But if slip happens to turns out to be difficult, if you don't have enough favorable slip planes for dislocation motion to happen through slip, then what might happen is all the energy that you are putting in may be in such a way that it actually can trigger twin. So in some materials you can actually initiate plastic deformation by twinning rather than by slipping. That is typically the case in BCC and HCP materials. But then the amount of plastic deformation, if you take a material, the amount of plastic deformation or the plastic strain caused by twinning is usually much smaller than the slip. Why is that? What happens when you have a twin deformation? If you see the primary difference between, okay, I will talk about it in a minute. If you see the primary difference between the slip and twin deformation, and this is how slip happens and this is how the twin happens. For slip, the crystallographic orientation above and below the slip plane remains same during the deformation. But for twin, what happens is because the atom motion is in such a way that there is a mirror image of one atom on one side of the plane to the other side, there is actually a rotation of the lattice or the rotation of the lattice around the twin boundary. And as a result, if you have initiated twin deformation, it is possible that by rotation of the grain, you may be actually bringing new slip systems into action, which were not available otherwise. Just by twin deformation, you are actually changing the orientation of the crystal planes, and hence the your direction of the loading is the same, but because of the twin, the crystal orientations are reorienting. As a result, the new slip planes and new slip directions are coming into action, and that is how you will cause slip followed by twin. And that is typically what happens in many of these BCC and HCP materials. Initially you will cause twinning, and then the twinning deformation reorients the plane in such a way that you will activate new slip systems. What do you mean by activate new slip systems? Your direction of the loading has not changed. When we say activating new slip systems, means that the phi and lambda values are changing without actually changing the direction of the orientation in your Smith factor. How phi and lambda changing? Only when the crystals reorient themselves. So this twinning is causing this reorientation and hence bringing new slip systems into action, and that is how you can cause further slip. Okay, and as we have discussed, the slip occurs in distinct atomic spacing multiples, whereas twin displacement is less than interatomic spacing. So the most important effect of twinning in a material is actually to reorient crystal planes such that it places new planes in a favorable orientation for slip to occur, the way that we have discussed just now. All right, so that's about one dimensional defects, line defects. Now the next kind of defects are interfacial defects. So there are different kinds of interfacial defects. What are these interfacial defects? They are basically the boundaries that separate the regions of materials with different crystallographic orientation. You have a material, in one place you have a particular crystallographic orientation, in another place you have another orientation. The boundary that separates these two orientations is what you call an interface. And every material, even a single crystal material, will have a boundary. What would that boundary be? The external surface, right? For every material you have external surface, and the external surface, your order ends at the external surface, and on the atoms on the external surface are not surrounded by the same number of neighbors compared to its bulk. Then it is missing neighbors on the outer side of the external surface. As a result, what happens? The energy of the system increases. That is what your surface energy is called, right? Whenever you have a body, suppose if you take a liquid, what happens? Because on the external surface all the water molecules are not bonded by equal number of neighbors below, and as a result the surface increases its energy, but the system should always try to minimize its surface energy. As a result, what it should do? It should reduce the surface area, and that is the reason why liquids take the shape spherical droplets, because they are the minimum surface area, but because it will not be always spherical droplet, it will have other shapes because of other forces coming into picture, so, but eventually it will have to minimize its surface area. But what happens for solids? The external surface of a solid will always be going towards spherical shape. It is not possible because of the rigidity of the solid. The solid has other factors coming into picture, and hence it cannot take. But nevertheless, because of the free surface, the external surfaces have some energy, right? They are usual, that is what increases the energy of the system, right? So now, that is, external surfaces are one kind of interface. So for every material, external surface, if you are talking about a perfect crystal, external surface is a defect. Normally your long range order is stopping at the external surface, so you can also see that as a kind of a defect. And the second important defect is the grain boundary. So here you can see a micrograph. So the scale here is 30 micrometers, right? So you can see that this is one grain with a particular crystallographic orientation. This is one, this is one, and this is one. And this interface is your orientation mismatch, and that comes out when you look under microscope. That nicely comes out as a grain boundary, right? So here you have different kinds of grain boundaries. How do you distinguish different kinds of grain boundaries? There are typically low angle grain boundaries and high angle grain boundaries. So what do you mean by low angle grain boundary? So let us say this is a cartoon of a crystalline material with different grain orientation. Can you see the different orientations here? So that is one boundary, right? So actually it should have been, so there is also another boundary here, right? This is one grain, this is another grain, and so on, and this is another boundary. Like that you can draw all the boundaries. And now, so in this grain, this is the orientation, right? And in the neighboring grain, this is the orientation, isn't it? So now, if that is the orientation of that grain and this is the orientation of this grain, the angle between those two guys is called misorientation. And if the angle is large, then it is called high angle grain boundary. For instance, if you take these two grains, that is one orientation, this is another orientation. Here, compared to this guy, this is a low angle grain boundary, okay? So these are the different kinds of, so this is in a polycrystalline material because you have several, it is not a single orientation. If it is a single crystal material, you will not have these boundaries because there is no misorientation. It is a polycrystalline material, so then you will see different kinds of grain boundaries, low angle grain boundary, high angle grain boundaries, and so on. And there is another thing called tilt boundary, right? So this is your grain 1 and this is your grain 2 and this is your misorientation. So this can also be caused by this dislocation structures. If you have dislocations of this kind, then eventually you will have a tilt boundary as we have shown, okay? So we have also discussed, so the boundary, twin boundary, about which you are actually having the misorientation, right? That is also a defect, the twin plane that we have seen. So the twin boundary is a special boundary along which you will have a specific mirror symmetry. But the long range order is actually going to be disturbed along the twin boundary, isn't it? Because they are constrained to move in a specific fashion. And again, as we have discussed, slip, twinning also occurs on preferential planes and preferential directions. And this twinning can be due to two mechanisms. One is due to mechanical stress. Another way you can initiate twinning is through heat treatment, annealing heat treatment. We will see what do you mean by annealing towards the end of this course when we discuss heat treatment. So when you apply a mechanical stress, you can initiate twinning in a material, and that is typically the mechanism observed in BCC and HCP materials. For FCC materials, it is difficult because the moment you apply a load, the fact that there are so many favorable slip systems, FCC materials at room temperature, they simply deform by slip. They don't have to go towards the twinning mechanism.
However,
when you are doing heat treatment in FCC materials, you can actually also initiate twinning through annealing. If you do annealing, so you can initiate twinning in FCC materials, but otherwise at room temperature normally it is not a predominant mechanism. Okay, so the twinning is primarily seen in BCC and HCP materials. So what are the other interfacial defects? Stacking faults. We have discussed stacking faults, right? ABC, ABC, close packet directions. And so for instance, ABC, ABC, FCC, and here A should be there, A is missing, right? If only one is there, then narrow stacking fault, and if there are so many defects, then it is wider stacking, right? And you have face boundaries. That means if you have a material with multiple faces, and the boundary between one face to another face is called face boundary. And similarly, you have ferromagnetic and ferroelectric materials in which you will have domain walls. What are these domain walls? For instance, if you are talking about a ferromagnetic material, the magnetic orientation vector, it changes from one region to another region. So the boundary that separates the orientation difference is called domain wall. So when you look under a microscope, you can actually observe these domain walls in these magnetic materials. Yeah, if you do a characterization of these systems. All right, so these are the different kinds of two dimensional defects. So what is the summary of these interfacial defects? We know that the atoms at the boundary, whether it be internal surface or external surface, internal boundary or external boundary, they are usually less regularly arranged or bonded, and as a result the boundary will have higher energy. So grain boundaries, if you see the energy state near the grain boundary and the bulk, grain boundaries will have higher energy state because the atoms are not regularly arranged. And hence what happens is your impurities, for instance, if you have an impurity in a material, it preferentially tries to go and sit near the grain boundary so as to minimize the grain boundary energy, right? It is already a high energy state, it will go and sit there so as to minimize the grain boundary energy. As a result, total energy of the system is minimized. So you have high angle grain boundary and low angle grain boundary, because high angle grain boundary means what? The misorientation is larger. When you have misorientation is larger, that means you have large irregularity, as a result you will have higher energy. And low angle grain boundary, the irregularity is less and hence you will have low energy. Because of the fact that the grain boundaries have higher energy, they are chemically more reactive compared to the bulk. So if you have any chemical reaction that needs to take place, that preferentially happens near the grain boundary because they are already in the high energy state. And as a, because of the same reason why that the grain boundaries have higher energies, the impurity atoms in a material typically try to go and sit near the grain boundaries so that they can minimize the total energy of the system, right? This is important to know why these impurity atoms go and sit near the grain boundaries and why chemical reactions take place near the grain boundary, because that is going to help us understand the solidification process when we talk about phase diagrams. You guys have already got introduced to phase diagrams in manufacturing process. That is something that we will end with in this course, okay. And then the next level of defects are volume defects, like pores. If you have a material, if you have a porosity, that is a volume defect. Cracks, foreign inclusions, other faces, these are the other kinds of defects that you can have in materials, and we are not going to discuss much about them, but what is the effect of them on the plastic deformation is something that we can look at.